is a CBS News Special Report. I'm Norah O'Donnell in our nation's capital, and we have breaking news from the United Kingdom, where we have just sad news that Queen Elizabeth II, the longest-serving British monarch, died today at Balmoral Castle. That is her summer home in Scotland. Her Majesty was 96 years old and had spent a record 70 years on the throne. We want to show you live pictures from Buckingham Palace, her home for decades. We just received the news from the royal family. They sent out a statement saying the Queen died peacefully at Balmoral this afternoon. The King and the Queen consort will remain at Balmoral this evening and will return to London tomorrow. Thus referring to Prince Charles now as the King of England. It was just early this morning here in the U.S. that Buckingham Palace announced that the Queen was under medical supervision, and all morning long we have been waiting for word, watching as the Queen's children, grandchildren, other members of the royal family rushed to be with her, at her side, at the inn. We want to show you these shots of the royal family arriving at Aberdeen Airport in Scotland. This, of course, first of all, the flag at half-staff. This is the plane that arrived earlier this morning. And then we saw Prince William arrive at Balmoral with his uncles, Princes Andrew and Edward. There they are in the car together. This, of course, a watershed moment, not just for the British people, but the world. And, you know, in England, many people have not really known any other monarch because she reigned for so long. She reigned over a rapidly changing country in the last days of a once vast empire. And through it all, many people say that the Queen ruled with a steady hand and quite a devotion to the British people, always talking about her service to the nation. And her oldest son, Prince Charles, succeeds her now as Britain's new king. Mark Phillips now has the Queen's extraordinary life story.
She was not born to be queen, but she became so much more than the ceremonial head of state of a mid-sized European country. Elizabeth Alexandra Mary Windsor, Queen Elizabeth II, reinvented the British monarchy and may have saved it. Elizabeth was already 10 years old when another royal drama led to her becoming heir to the throne. In 1936, her uncle, Edward VIII, abdicated to marry the American divorcee Wallace Simpson, and the royal line shifted to her father, George VI, and so to her. The young Princess Elizabeth was already a public favorite. During the Second World War, she had worked to raise the country's morale. And she had also served as a volunteer in the war effort.
I am sure that you are often thinking of the old country to make the world of tomorrow a better and happier place.
Her marriage to Philip Mountbatten, an anglicized member of the deposed Greek royal family, gave a war-weary country something to celebrate. And the children the marriage produced, first Charles and then Anne, secured the future. Elizabeth's coronation in 1953 was the first ever to be televised. Its combination of ancient ceremony and glittering glamour cemented her as the personification of Britain's post-war rebirth. And it began a reign with a singular purpose.
I declare before you all that my whole life, whether it be long or short, shall be devoted to your service.
Elizabeth's reign would be the longest ever in a royal bloodline that goes back over 1,000 years. But the royal ride was sometimes bumpy. The stability and continuity the monarchy was supposed to provide began to look shaky as one by one the royal marriages broke down around her. Her sister Margaret's, her daughter Anne's, her son Andrew's. They all ended in awkward divorces. None was uglier than the breakup of Prince Charles and Diana Spencer. The long public unraveling of the marriage of the heir to the throne seemed to shake the very foundations of the royal household. When, in the early 1990s, Windsor Castle also went up in flames, the Queen's famous stoicism was tested.
1992 is not a year on which I shall look back with undiluted pleasure.
in the words of one of my more sympathetic correspondents, it has turned out to be an annus horribilis.
However horrible the year, the Windsor Castle fire and the public complaints over the skyrocketing repair costs produced a turning point in royal history. Monarchs normally collect taxes, but from then on, the Queen agreed to pay taxes on her income. Royal behavior was also changed by the shocking death of Diana in that Paris car crash. The national outpouring of grief seemed to highlight the emotional gap between the Queen and her people. Elizabeth did much to repair the damage with a single bow of the head to the passing coffin of a popular princess.
No one who knew Diana will ever forget her. Millions of others who never met her, but felt they knew her, will remember her.
There would be other challenges. One of the most serious centering around the wife of one of Diana's sons. When Prince Harry's biracial American wife, Meghan Markle, complained of mistreatment by palace officials, the couple renounced the royal life and moved to California. When Elizabeth's husband, Prince Philip, who she had described as her strength, died, she was left alone to face the last chapter of her reign. Over seven decades on the throne, Elizabeth redefined the monarchy, remade it for a more modern, less deferential age. And in the process, she became not just Queen of Great Britain, she became, in a way, Queen of the World. Mark Phillips, CBS News, London.
And a remarkable life and legacy we want to show you now. Live pictures from Buckingham Palace, where they have just posted the notice of Her Majesty's passing. Out front, where there are crowds have gathered there. Holly Williams is there outside Buckingham Palace, and Holly, there have been signs that her health was failing in recent days.
That's correct, Nora. I mean, she's been in poor health for months now, experiencing mobility issues. We've frequently seen her using a walking stick. She's missed some very important events because of her health, including some of the events at her Platinum Jubilee, which was celebrated this past summer. And then this week, the UK has a new Prime Minister. The new Prime Minister has to meet the Queen. Typically, that happens here in London at Buckingham Palace, but it was unprecedented this time. The new Prime Minister, Liz Truss, travelled around 500 miles to Scotland to meet the Queen. And those, I believe, the final images that we have of the Queen appearing in public, looking very elderly and very frail. I think it's impossible to overstate the extent to which this is the end of an era. She was a tiny woman in physical stature, but she was a giant, a towering figure in this country. She ascended the throne when she was a fresh-faced young mother. She is leaving it a great-grandmother. When she ascended the throne, Winston Churchill was the Prime Minister in this country, and British people were enduring austerity following World War II. It is now a modern, multicultural society. I think Queen Elizabeth II's trademarks are known not just here in this country, but around the world. She was known for her big hats, for her love of bright colours, for her love of sensible shoes, and for her beloved corgi dog. She was always seemingly surrounded by a swarm of them. Then we can expect a period of several days of national mourning in this country. Her successor, as you mentioned, is Charles, her eldest son. As I said, this really is the end of an era. And to give you an indication of that, for more than 70 years, the national anthem of this country has been God Save the Queen. It will now become God Save the King.